First question, what does exactly the exascale challenge consist in? I like this this table. It has been extracted from the document referenced in the slide. By the way, throughout the presentation, I will reference several words in order to give you the reference for deeper details of the issues covered by the slides. And I like this table. It's from this document. It's a document from the U.S. Department of Energy. The table and the document, of course, comes from 2010. And I like this table because it's a good summary. I like it about how exascale system, APC system reaching exascale level should be. In the document, it is... That's the right button. Okay. In the document, it is stated that by the year 2018, an exascale system should reach, of course, one exaflop of performance, right? It's a exaflop per second of performance. Basically, this is the main objective of the exascale challenge. But I would like to point out also the second value. The second value of this table for 2018 is this one, 20 megawatts. 20 megawatts of production, right? This is very, very, very important because usually when we think about the exascale challenge, we only think about performance, but it's not just performance. It's performance at a very low power consumption considering the consumption level in 2018. Note that the factor change from 2010 to 2018 is 500. While the theoretical factor change in power from 2010 to 2018 is 3. We must drastically increase computational power while keeping power consumption very low, or at least power consumption shouldn't increase significantly, right? All right. This table also allows to imagine how far we are from reaching the goal, right? Because it's possible to have some values in 2013, the current year, about this metric, these values, and compare it both with 2010 and with 2018. That said, are we going in the right direction regarding computational power and power consumption? Let's take a look what have been doing during the last year. Basically, after the breakdown of Moore's Law and Dennard scaling, we cannot have, you know, of course, ever faster chips. We have an increase of power density when we increase the number of transistors and so on. All of you know this data. So what have been doing during the last years in order to achieve consumption? Basically, you know, we have been using multi-core processors and also, especially more recently, and so on. Okay, we have achieved a significant increase in computational power, sure. But the question is, are we going in the right direction regarding power consumption? Of course, all the companies and in general researchers or processors all around the world are really achieving interesting results regarding reducing power consumption in processors and accelerators and so on. ARM, Intel, AMD, NVIDIA are making interesting proposals regarding power consumption, reducing power consumption on processor and accelerator. But if we look at the last top 500 green list, you know, the list, the rank of the most power efficient machines in the world. At the top of this rank, we can find Aurora, and its performance per watt ratio is 3,200 megaflops per watt. With this ratio, we could reach one exaflop at the cost of with a power consumption of 311 megawatts. Very, very far, very far, very above 20 megawatts, right? That's the exascale challenge. Moreover, if we go to the top 500 list, top 500 list, we have that at the top of the rank, we can find Tian, By the way, if someone knows the exact pronunciation of TN, please let me know, because I don't know. We have a power consumption of 17.8 megawatts. So we have basically reached the expected power consumption for exascale, right? It's very close to 20 megawatts, expected for 2018. So it's clear, it's very clear, that we should drastically reduce the power per watt ratio, right, in high PC systems. It's basically the main challenge, the real challenge of exascale. What is the approach we think is more likely to be right to reach this goal, to drastically reduce power consumption? We think that exascale processors are likely to reduce peak performance in order to save more power, right? But in that case, we will have exascale system consisting of more processors, many more processors. Indeed, if we come back to the table, we can see that the expected system size in nodes is in the order of 1 million nodes. So it's likely that the approach of reducing peak performance of processor to reach to save computational power is right. Not only the system size, but also not concurrency. I mean, the number of CPUs, of course, per end node is in the order of 1,000 CPUs or 1,000 cores. So in that case, it's likely that exascale system will consist of many more processors, and in that case, we will have interconnection networks that should meet strong requirements regarding the number, obviously, the number of nodes to be interconnected, right? So it's necessary to have networks, interconnection networks with extreme connectivity, very, very high connectivity, as a main requirement, as a first requirement. However, achieving this level in interconnection network is, of course, not obvious, fortunately, for interconnection network researchers like me, right? But what do I mean with achieving interconnection network suitable for exascale system? Besides the fact of being able to interconnect a huge number of end nodes. If we come back again to the table, the only explicit value for interconnects is this one, interconnect bandwidth. Basically, it's listening bandwidth, the bandwidth provided to the ACAs, to the network cards. Link bandwidth, basically. But there are other implicit values, of course, in this table that affect interconnects. Mainly, I have mentioned already, the number of nodes to be interconnected, but also, of course, we come back again, the power consumption of the whole system. Currently, the power consumption fraction corresponding to is 35%. The total power consumption of the system. This is a lot of power for the network, right? We must reduce drastically also this power consumption in the network. Moreover, as we will show later, this power consumption is not only when the network is operating, but even when the network is idle, right? Around 20% of the total power consumed by the system is for the network, even when idle. So it's a clear challenge. The overall challenge for interconnects regarding exascale, in order to reach the exascale level, is not only to achieve, of course, a high connectivity, providing connectivity to a huge number, 1 million nodes, but also to achieve this, providing a good bandwidth, low latency, high throughput, and so on, the typical requirements for interconnect international networks, high performance interconnection network, but also to achieve this, reducing a lot the fraction of power consumption that can be provided to the network, right? Of course, this overall challenge can be divided into particular channels regarding any aspect of the interconnection networks. So we can talk about there is a channel regarding scalability, simplicity, reliability, fault tolerance in order to achieve the exascale levels. Of course, cost and power consumption using power saving techniques, and also congestion management. There are particular challenges, but all of these particular challenges affecting all the aspect in the design of interconnection networks should be coupled, should be linked in order to meet some performance requirements that is at the end the main goal of the exascale challenge. This must be considered not separately but strongly linked like the ingredients in a spaghetti dish, right? All right, in more detail, one of the main aspect in the design of interconnected networks to analyze regarding the exascale level, the exascale system is topology. Topology is one of the obvious characteristics of the network that should be rightly addressed when talking about exascale system. As I mentioned, the main objectives of a network in an exascale system is to provide high connectivity, of course, not only to provide high connectivity, but also to provide low latency and high throughput. I mean, great performance. We should expect a high performance from the network, and as I have mentioned, while reducing cost and power consumption. Of course, any of these objectives, all these objectives, affect the policy, right? What are, from our point of view, the right trends to achieve these goals regarding topology? From our point of view, the right trends to achieve these goals regarding topology may be, are likely to be, reducing network diameter in order to reduce latency, because if we have to connect a huge number of nodes, network diameter must be critical. We should reach more nodes in fewer hops in order to reduce latency. Optimizing the number of components, I mean not to overdimension the network in order to reduce, of course, cost, but also power consumption. It's not possible to give extra resources to the network, because in such a huge network, the extra components, it's impossible to provide. Another interesting trend is to propose and to implement, of course, cost-efficient routing algorithms in order to achieve great performance from the routing algorithms without requiring extra resources, without adding resources. It has strongly linked with simplicity. The simpler the algorithm, the lower the cost and the power consumption. And also it's interesting to increase path diversity in order to ease basically fault tolerance in such huge systems. Okay, considering these design trends, which are the topologies likely to be suitable for exascale systems? Let's take a look at the classic topologies. Classic topologies have been traditionally divided into direct and indirect networks, right? Direct networks, you know that its main drawback is that with a lower number of dimensions, we will have a very high network diameter, right? We can decrease network diameter by increasing the number of dimensions, of course, but in that case, we are increasing switch complexity and probably also routing complexity. In general, also, direct networks are cheaper than indirect networks. They require fewer switches and links. But performance is not so easy to achieve, mainly due to the high diameter and also due to several restrictions in the routing, because you know that these topologies contain cycles and it's necessary to have some restrictions in the routing in order to avoid deadlocks. Right? Nevertheless, some topologies like 3D Tori are very popular, and indeed in machines of the top 500, so they also use. Another very popular topologies are FAT trees. FAT trees are the most prominent example of indirect networks.
fatigues are present in many, many powerful machines. In contrast with direct networks, they use more switches in general. We can reduce the number of switches by using high-value switches, but of course this again increases complexity and probably cost and power consumption. Right. Number, network diameter is lower in general than in direct networks, and depends on the number of stages. We can decrease the number of stages again by using high-value switches, but this would increase switch complexity and cost and probably power consumption. An interesting feature of this network of trees is the possibility of using very, very cost-efficient routing algorithms. What do I mean with cost-efficient routing algorithms? I mean routing algorithms tailored to specific topologies that are able to achieve great performance with the format at a lower cost. In general, these algorithms are based on balancing the destinations among the different paths. Of course, not in the topology. They are completely topology-aware routing algorithms. And some of them are able to achieve the same performance as adaptive routing without requiring so many resources as adaptive routing requires. So it's very, very interesting to explore this possibility, tailor the routing algorithm to specific topologies in order to get deterministic, simple, extremely simple routing algorithms that requires not so many resources as adaptive routing in order to, of course, reduce cost and power consumption. To make a sample of these routing algorithms is the Dijkstra routing, also the routing proposed by Eric and Javi. They are algorithms that completely balance the traffic aim on the different links of the network, so that at any stage, for instance, all the links are used by a similar number of paths, an equal number of paths. So the traffic is completely balanced. It has been shown that this type of algorithms achieve the same performance as adaptive routing without requiring many resources. Indeed, they are very, very simple to implement. It's, of course, in our opinion, it's a very interesting trend. It's a very interesting trend to follow this idea regarding routing, to couple complete topology in the routing algorithms in order to get the simplest routing algorithm possible while providing a suitable performance. Right? All right. Anyway, both direct and indirect network classic topologies have some limitations. I've mentioned some of them. In general, direct networks are cheap, require fewer switches, in general, of course, but it's not easy to achieve a great performance. By contrast, indirect networks are more or less expensive, they require more many switches and links, but it's easier to get a higher performance with this type of networks. In general, again, direct networks have have a high network diameter, while in general, indirect networks have a lower length of paths, lower network diameter. So, as both types of topologies present some limitations, in general, researchers regarding topologies have been exploring new paths, new ways to provide great performance by means of different topologies. New topologies have arisen during the last year. One of the most explored topologies are hierarchical networks, dragonflies being the most prominent example. I will not go into great detail because there is another talk today from Frank Olaf about the dragonflies, so I will almost skip this type of topology. Just to say that these topologies reduce network diameter by having several levels in the hierarchy, so network diameter is very reduced. Also, they present some problems regarding the length of the path and also the high number of required links, right? In general, in this topology. As I mentioned, Frank Olaf will give you a deepest view of the dragonfly topologies, and I want to draw your attention to a different type of topologies, not so known as dragonflies, but that, from our point of view, are very interesting. They are highly networked, specifically the topology known as KNS. KNS is a hybrid topology. It's a mix of direct and indirect network. But basically, it can be seen as a mesh of indirect networks, right? The network consists in several types of points. We have, on the one hand, the end nodes, the routers, and the switches. Switches may be just a crossbar, or if we don't have crossbar with a required number of ports, we can have a FAT3 or any type of indirect networks at this point, right, in the switches. Switches connect different rows and columns in the network, and the rows consist of routers that ideally, instead of being crossbar or any type of switch, routers could be just ACH cards. For instance, InfiniBand cards have two ports that may be enough for this type of topology if we assume that these two ports in the cards bypass the end node and are able to route packets from one of these directly from one of these ports of the card to the other part of the card, to the other port of the card. By means of this topology, we get an excellent performance. Diameter is reduced. Also, the number of switches and links is reduced. We provide also a high path diversity in order to ease fault tolerance for future fault tolerance mechanisms, right? And also we achieve a low latency thanks to reducing the diameter and so on. It's also easy to get efficient router algorithms because to translate the classic router algorithm is quite easy. I want to show you the origin of the name KNS very, very quickly. KNS comes from having K nodes per dimension, N dimension, and S stages in the interconnection network, if any. Right? We may have just a crossbar in these switches. Right? An example of routing algorithm is just the classical dimension of the routing. It's very easy to apply to this topology. But I would like to point out that it's very clear that the network diameter has been reduced with respect to for instance, to a mesh. In a mesh, we would have to have all these hops to reach this destination from the source, and in this case, with a couple of hops, we reach the destination. So it's clear that we reduce the network diameter, also reduce the number of switches. So, it's very likely that this type of topologies, maybe not exactly this one, but maybe a similar one, combining the properties of direct and indirect networks, are suitable for exascale systems, right? Anyway, there is still an issue to be solved to implement this type of topologies, especially regarding how to implement the routers with a higher number of dimensions. For three dimensions or four dimensions and so on, it's not clear. You wouldn't have routers able to bypass packets from some port without being actually a crossbar and so on. Also, this infrastructure, this topology, should be provided with fault tolerance and power efficiency mechanism, and also with congestion management. And we have already explored the possibilities of congestion management in this topology. I will show you later. Recently proposed mechanism, but anyway, it's a way to explore. It's definitely a way to explore having this type of mechanism of topologies, hybrid topologies. Fault tolerance, of course, in exascale system with a huge number of nodes, really huge interconnects, would be maybe mandatory to have some type of fault tolerance mechanisms. Providing alternative paths because the probability of having failures in the network would increase in size, of course, right? Oh, excuse me again. So, fault tolerance may become a mandatory issue. Currently, we're exploring the possibility of applying or already proposed mechanisms of fault tolerance like DF3SP, LASH, so on, to existing topologies or promising topologies like the KNS and so on. Anyway, it's clear that the fault tolerance must be analyzed in order to reach the scale challenge, and any network, the exact system, should be provided with some type of fault tolerance mechanism. Another essential aspect, as I have mentioned, is power efficiency. Power efficiency is, as I have mentioned at the beginning of the presentation, of the keynote, a key issue. We must reduce drastically the power consumption of the network. As I have mentioned, even when ideal, the network consumes 20% of the total power of the system. So we must reduce it drastically and in the best way possible. Of course, I have mentioned some ways to reduce power consumption in by means of topology design. For instance, if we don't have too many components in the topology, we will reduce cost and at the same time power consumption. We can use cost-efficient Rothen algorithms in order to have not so complex switches and so on, in order to also reduce power consumption. But now, I mean more aggressive power-saving policies, because probably just with additional mechanisms that the one topology is not possible to achieve the exascale levels of power consumption, to reduce the power consumption until the desired levels in the exascale system. So it's very likely that aggressive policies for power saving must be implemented in the exascale system. It's strange that many policies have been applied in the design of a processor in order to save power, but not so many proposals have been made for interconnection network regarding power saving, right? So that it is still a challenge. It is still a challenge to have a really, really power efficient techniques, power saving techniques for interconnects. Nevertheless, there are some proposals, most of them take into account that most of the interconnect energy is spent by the links, even when the links are idle. Also, the number and length of the link is important. Of course, the more links, the more power consumption. The greater the length, the greater the power consumption. You can see in that figure that even with very low traffic load, the power consumption is great. Vale? The ideal, and this is the trend, power consumption is great even when traffic load is low. Contention also increases power consumption because we will have oversubscription of our resources in the network, so we will have to transmit and to keep to storage information for more time, so this will also increase power consumption. Carbon solutions. The few current solutions for power saving interconnection network consider all these to reduce in some way these power consumptions. These current solutions can be divided into hardware and software proposal. Basically, software solutions are a proactive solution. They try to scale in traffic so that hot spots or contention are minimized to reduce contention in order to reduce subsequently power consumption and to keep the network in low utilization. Of course, no way for this type of philosophy in the exascale system, right? Link speed will increase, traffic scheduling exascale system would be very, very, very complex. And of course, we don't want actually to have the network with low utilization. And even if we want the network in low utilization, the consumption of the power when ideal would be still significant. So no way for this philosophy. Hardware solutions are more aggressive solutions. For instance, dynamic voltage scaling techniques, going on and off the components of the network when not used and so on. And more specifically, turning off the links completely are interesting proposals. Of course, it's possible to do it, but this would solve the problem of the network when idle, the problem of the idle power, but they are probably too complex to apply to exascale system. Not that it would be necessary to have a mandatory fault tolerance mechanism, fault tolerance growth and algorithm, right, in order to bypass the power of components. Of course, we must have path diversity, but even if we have fault tolerance mechanisms, path diversity, and so on, and we can skip the complexity, the additional complexity, again, this proposal would react very slowly to traffic burst. Reaction time would be critical in order to powering on again some components required when traffic bars are present in the network. The traffic bars will probably require all the resources available in the network. So it would be very difficult to react in time when these bars appear. There is a not so aggressive solution following this trend, following this philosophy, that is that the links are actually an aggregation of links, right? Parallel links, 2x, 4x, 8x, and so on. It would be possible to turn in on and off, not complete to the links, but only some of the components of the link, some of the lines, right? From my own point of view, this is interesting, because in that case, connectivity wouldn't be affected, right? It wouldn't be necessary to have a perfect fault tolerance mechanism. Connectivity is affected. The path would be still the path, lower bandwidth, but the path would exist yet. And of course, the routing algorithm is preserved. We don't need to change the routing in this case. From our point of view, this last is probably the right trend. It's interesting to explore this trend in order to provide power saving techniques. But even if we have an interesting proposal or a final technique efficient in that sense, the problem of the slow reaction would be still there. Right? This problem wouldn't disappear. Because even having the path, slow reaction would be a problem when traffic bars appear, traffic bar or any type of intense traffic clogging the network, right? Also, it's likely that this is the right way if we provide the system with a suitable congestion management mechanism, so that we can turn off and on some components of the links, and when traffic bars or intense traffic appear in the network, we can apply some type of congestion management mechanism. The reason of the combining power efficient power saving techniques with congestion management is not the only one, of course, to use congestion management in the networks. Note that in general, for exascale system, cost and power consumption constraints will be high, very high. So we cannot overdimension the network, as I have mentioned before. So we should have the minimal number of components able to interconnect such a huge number of nodes as is required in exascale system. So if we don't overdimension the network, we will be working very close to the saturation zone of the network. So it's very likely that congestion appear in the form of bars, hotspots, and so on. So it's likely also that a congestion management mechanism will be required in exascale system. Of course, always from our point of view, right? Well, what do we have regarding congestion management mechanisms currently? First, I would like to draw your attention to the main problems derived from congestion situations, right? One of the well-known problems is headline blocking. Headline blocking is caused by hot flows, creating hot spots. Now, the hot flows may share queues with other flows, cold flows, that are not contributing to congestion, and in that case, the cold flows will advance at the same speed as hot flows, and network performance decreasing very, very quickly. Right? We like to divide headline blocking into two types of headline blocking. Low-order head-only blocking. Low-order head-only blocking, that is basically the head-only blocking produced in the same switch where contention appears. In that case, this is hot spot in this point, and these red flows are creating the hot spot. The yellow one is suffering head-only blocking. Although it is not addressed to the hot spot, it's suffering the same delay as the other flows. And we also have, this is assumed to this hotspot, and we also have high order head line blocking. This is the head line blocking created by back pressure from the switch with congestion appear. Right? In that case, for instance, in switch 6, we have high order head line blocking because this queue, by means of flow control, prevents packet from arriving at the original speed. So they suffer the same delay as the flows that reach this switch where congestion appear. I think there are another example in this figure of high-order head-only blocking. Exactly, it's the same situation. This head-only blocking is created by flow control from the switch where congestion appear. We like to divide the head-only blocking in these two types because the solutions proposed for head-only blocking differ greatly on the type of head-only blocking they are able to avoid or to prevent, right? I will go back to this point later. Another problem, of course, is buffer hogging. Buffer hogging, when we have a congestion situation, hot flows take most of the buffer space. But note that this is also possible even if we have a lot of resources devoted to prevent this buffer hogging. For instance, usual solutions to prevent buffer hogging is to use virtual lanes. We may have different virtual lanes in the buffers of the switches and so on. And even we may have different reports in the switch in order to connect any packet from these virtual lanes to the corresponding output port requested by these packets. Even having virtual lanes and even having reports, we still may have problems with hogging. Right, because there is some type of hogging that we call intra-VL hogging, that is the one produced by flows taking not most of the buffer space, but most of the space of this virtual lane. Right, so all the flows sharing a virtual lane may suffer intra-VL hogging from another hot flow. Right. So solving the problem of segment hogging is not easy because the usual solutions, virtual lanes, different queues and so on, and even different reports, are not able to solve this problem. Right? That said, what are the current solutions for congestion management, the solutions usually implemented in real hardware? Basically, besides having many proposals in that sense, the current solution for head-only blocking belong to two groups: reactive techniques, basically ingestion absorption techniques, and head-only blocking prevention techniques, basically queuing schemes like VQ switch and so on. Reactive techniques, basically ingestion absorption, rely on modifying the sources of congestion in order to throttle the ingestion or even reduce it, or even completely ceasing the injection of packets, right? This is, in fact, the solution of InfiniBand. InfiniBand reconfigure mechanism is a reactive mechanism, injection throttling mechanism. Packets crossing a congested area are marked with a FECON bit, and when these packets are received at the final points, a beacon marked packet is sent to the sources in order to redeem for throttling injection. These mechanisms have some drawbacks. Mainly, these don't scale with network size and bandwidth. Why? Because obviously, network diameter, network size, delay the reception of notification, so the reaction may be too late when it is received. Also, link and buffer capacity are not good. The greatest the capacity of the link, the worse for this type of techniques. Why? Because the delay in the reception makes the problem worse, we have a high link capacity. More hot packets may be ingested in the network during that time.
Right. So,
also, it's possible to have traffic oscillations and a typical closed-loop control system oscillation and so on. Nevertheless, it's an interesting philosophy, interesting type of mechanisms to be explored and to be tuned for exascale system.
Although it's necessary to solve many problems, especially regarding scalability. Other types of implemented solutions.
Queuing schemes, right? Hot blocking prevention techniques.
Most of them are based on having at the buffer different queues, virtual lanes, or so on, in order to separate traffic flows so that flows shaking a queue may suffer heavy lane blocking, but not flows in different queues. So it's a way to prevent flows to interact between them in order to prevent heavy lane blocking. Classical schemes in this group are very well known, like BOQNet, so having at every port, at every buffer, as many queues as end nodes in the network, so that all the flows are completely separated, but of course this is not feasible at all.
This is a passing scale with network size. A very popular approach is
virtual output queues at a switch level, so in that case we will have as many queues in the buffer as output ports in the switch.
Note that this
scheme prevents low order header lane blocking, the header lane blocking in the same switch where congestion appears, but not high order. Right? Only partially and only by collateral effects.
Right?
Dump queues are a similar scheme as BQ switch, and DPBM is another proposal that reduces low order and high order prevention only partially. These schemes have in common that they are topology agnostic schemes, so they are not tailored to any specific topology. On the contrary, recent proposals tailor the queue schemes both
to topology and
algorithm. Right? From our point of view, these are much more interesting approaches. Right? For instance, OBQA has been tailored to FAT trees. BF3 and Flow2SL also to FAT3s, and we have recently proposed a queuing scheme suitable for this topology for KNAs, as I explained before, that reduces significantly header lane blocking, both low order and high order, right? By using fewer queues than any other of the former schemes. Basically, by tailoring
the scheme to the
topology and the Rothian algorithm. Right. An example of this last scheme, an example of BBQ. BBQ comes from band-based queuing, right? Maybe the guy who proposed the name also liked the barbecues, but all right. This scheme is so simple as this. We divide a KNS topology into bands, maybe four bands, four queues per port, right? Every port, there is a queue for any of the bands of the network, so that packets addressed to different bands never share queues, right? With this very simple scheme, we achieve the same result as BOQ switch, or very similar result to BOQ switch, or even better results than BOQ switch, by using fewer resources, only four queues per port, while in some of this configuration, BOQ switch are using 16 or even 32 queues per port. We reduce the number of queues per port required by BOQ switch in a factor of 8 or 4, right? By applying just this simple scheme, by applying this formula in order to map packet to queues, right? The selective queue and a port is
my destination
for a number of queues divided by the number of end nodes. It's a very simple scheme. It's not a dynamic scheme, so packets are assigned to a queue before injection, right? And we achieve interesting results. We achieve a very significant reduction in header lane blocking, both lower the header lane blocking and also high forwarding heterogeneous blocking. It's a scheme very easy to implement in Infiniman technology, right? We can assign each packet an SL, right, according to this formula, and then it's only necessary to fill the SL to VL tables so that VL is SL, right? As we have shown, BBQ with four Qs is the black cycle, and BQNet, the unfeasible optimal scheme, is the blue one. So we are not too far from the scheme, right? With just four Qs per port, it's a strong reduction. These figures are for hotspot situations. The former was for uniform traffic. Hotspot situation, we achieve a very close performance as BBQNet, that is an unfeasible and a very, very expensive scheme, right? These schemes, I have mentioned, are static in the sense that the mapping of packets to queues doesn't change, right? But we achieve very good results, as I have mentioned, by tailoring, as I have mentioned, the topology to the mapping scheme, right? This is, from our point of view, a very interesting trend to follow and to explore in any topology, right? If we are able to propose tailored queuing schemes suitable for any topology, right, we will be able to have a great low order and high order heterogeneous blocking reduction with few resources, so reducing cost and power consumption. We have also proposed some metrics to evaluate how good is a tailored mapping scheme of traffic flows to queues, right? The metrics we propose are these three. VL low is the number of flows mapped to a VL in a specific port. Of course, this strongly depends on the Rothen algorithm. Very interesting is the balancing degree, is the variation between the maximum and minimum values of VL loads. Ideally, we should have the same value for the minimum and for the maximum. I mean, balance the assignation of VLs of destinations to the VLs. And also, it's very interesting to have a zero or minimal overlapping degree. So, we should have a very low overlapping degree between the VLs. I mean, it's not good to have the same destination, the same flows assigned to different VLs, right? Because in that case, if some of the flows becomes a hot flow, this will affect a higher number of VLs, so to a higher number of cold flows, excuse me, right? Many flows may be affected by the same hot flow, right? So ideally, balancing degree as even as possible, overlapping degree as low as possible. It's quite easy to analyze, to analytically evaluate the mapping policy with this. With these metrics, right? On the other hand, the former schemes were static mapping schemes, so the mapping of packet flows is independent of the situation of the traffic in the network. On the opposite, by contrast, there are only proposed, never implemented, dynamic mapping queuing schemes. Maybe you know all of them, the record-like scheme, so mechanisms that detect congestion, then allocate queues assigned to specific flows, the flows contributing to congestion, then congestion information is propagated in order to allocate new queues for separating hot flows and cold flows and so on. The family of mechanisms are RECON for subrouting mechanism, for subrouting networks, ABICM for distributed based network, DRBCM for factories using destro like routing algorithms for deterministic cost efficient routing algorithms and so on, right? This is the basics of these mechanisms. I would like to point out only that they require to store condition information in control memories. Probably this is the main reason for not being implemented yet, right? So this is a serious drawback to be solved in the future. Basically, at every port, we require not only the RAM divided into queues, but also we require a control memory to store congestion information in the form of maybe a congestion addressable memory or a TCAM, a temporary content addressable memory. This is a mandatory requirement that, as I have mentioned, make this type of mechanisms difficult to implement in current switches, right? This is a ternary CAM. This is an example for DRBCM, this type of mechanism for factories. Basically, what we have to store there is a max in order to identify where the congestion point is. In the case of factories using the store routing algorithm, it's easy to have this type of max. For instance, this mark, this max represents this point in the this point in the network, because all the deletes reaching this point from this one have these bits, right, to zero, while the others are wildcards, right? So it's possible to store the situation of this point by means of the codification, ternary codification with bits O1 and wildcard of the destination passing through this point. This is the key of this technique. It's possible to locate this point even in upstream switches by means of this type of codification. But it's true that we require this type of storage, these control memories, to implement these mechanisms. So it's a hard drawback. It's a strong requirement. And moreover, it's possible that some of the ports run out of queues when several congestion points appear in the network. Right? If we come back to this situation, we have a limited number of entries in the CAM, in the control memory, and also have a limited number of special queue to isolate hot flows. So in extreme situations of congestion, we may run out of
resources. We may run out of lines,
both in the RAM and in the CAM, in the control memory. Right. So I have to say that these type of mechanisms theoretically achieve excellent performance. They completely remove the probability of head-on blocking. Actually, prevent head-on blocking, right? But they are quite difficult to implement, and it would be possible in extreme situation to run out of resources, so the mechanism would fail.
Regarding performance, you can say that this is a figure with experiments with real traces
that we achieve. This is the DRBCM, even same performance as BioQNet. Basically the same performance as BioQNet, that is the all blue bar, right? But as I have mentioned, there are many drawbacks, right? The cost, the implementation of the control memories, the possibility of having running out in some ports, and also some unfairness in the scheduling of hot flows. We have explored another possibilities that is mixing congestion management based on dynamic mapping, I mean isolation of hot flows, with injection throttling. Why? In order to prevent the mechanism from running out of special queues. The injection throttling mechanism, an Infiniman-like congestion throttling mechanism, is active, and the hot flows are eliminated before the ports run out of special queues. The results can be found in this paper. Basically, the results are quite good, right? We are able to manage congestion at a good performance. This is the ideal level of BioQNet. This is the result achieved by these techniques. This technique is called CCFIT, right? And this is achieved just with two special queues per port, and of course with two lines in the control memory, right? So it's interesting. The system works. This is the figure for standalone mechanisms of injection throttling and standalone mechanism of dynamic mapping, right? So by combining these two mechanisms, we achieve this improvement in performance, right? They complement each other. Basically, they complement each other. The drawbacks one are solved by the other one and the opposite, right? So, summing up the situation of congestion management regarding exascale, what are the right way? That's a very good question. We think that we should explore still all these simple mechanisms, injector throttling, probably improving scalability in some way. Also, it's very interesting to explore static mapping of packets to queues, static mapping queuing schemes. Of course, tailoring, from our point of view, tailoring to the topology and growth algorithms, always. And if possible, we can, we need more effectiveness regarding congestion management, congestion elimination. We can use dynamic mapping of hot flow, this expensive mechanism, if we can afford this, right? Or combining injector throttling or using some type of not yet discovered type of combination of philosophies or approaches of congestion management. So that's almost all. I want to remark just that the exascale goals require to reduce peak performance in the processor so that we will require improved networks, of course, interconnection networks, right? And nodes. We have to connect 1,000 processors. Network interface will increase link speed, and if we have to connect around 1 million of end nodes, of course, we have to improve drastically the current interconnection networks. How? Basically, with some of the trends I have tried to mention along the presentation, we have to reduce diameter to achieve low latency and keep the high throughput. This affects, of course, topology. We should use efficient routing algorithms, simple routing algorithms, in order to have good performance without requiring many resources. We have to provide networks with some mechanism of fault tolerance, almost mandatory. And we have, of course, and very, very, very important, to reduce power consumption, especially the power consumption fraction of the networks, either by means of power efficiency solution or using non-ordination topologies. Probably both are mandatory, right? Will be mandatory in the future. And also, I think that the right trend is to use congestion management mechanisms to prevent performance degradation, either optimizing the use of available resources by means of tailored topology, queuing schemes, and so on, and improving efficiency with additional resources, if possible, by using dynamic mapping and congestion management mechanisms, and so on. That's all. Thank you very much for your attention. And if you have any questions?
Any questions for Pedro?